set the captives free. You came to bring us liberty. My sin, my rejection, your blood, my acceptance. Now I'm alive to bring you praise. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Every chain is broken through you, Jesus. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Whoa. Covered every sin. Your grace empowers me to win. My pain, my oppression, your blood, my acceptance. Now I'm alive to bring you praise. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Every chain is broken through you, Jesus. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Whoa. And sing. I'm free, I'm free, I'm free to shout it out. I'm free, I'm free, I'm free to dance and sing. I'm free, I'm free, I'm free to worship you. I'm gonna worship you. Of this life, are your mercies in disguise? We pray for wisdom, your voice to hear. We cry in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness, we doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not enough. And all the while, you hear each desperate plea, long that we'd have faith to believe. What if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? When friends betray us, when darkness seems to win, we know that pain reminds this heart that this is not our home. It's not our home. What if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life, the greatest storms, longest nights, are your mercies in disguise? You've gone to win my war. You come back with the head of my enemy. You come back and you call it my victory. My greatest defense, it leads me from the dry wilderness. All I did was praise. All I did was worship. All I did was bow down. It was stay still. Hallelujah, you have saved me. So much better your way. Hallelujah, great defender. So much better. The shade I'm living in, you restore my faith and hope again. All I did was praise. All I did was worship. All I did was bow down. introduced me to your love. You picked up all my pieces, put me back together. You are the defender of my heart. When I thought I lost me, you knew where I left me. You reintroduced me to your love. Picked up all my pieces, put me back together. You are the defender of my heart. When I thought I lost me, you knew where I left me. You reintroduced me to your love. You picked up all my pieces, put me back together. You are the defender of my heart. Hallelujah, you have saved me. So much better your way. Hallelujah, great defender. So much better your way.
A few years ago, I was talking with this family, and it was the parents and their four adult children, and three out of the four adult children were pastoring different churches. And I asked one of them, because they were local, where they were pastoring, and they told me, and they were younger, and so I asked if they were youth pastors, and they said, no, we're leading a church right now. And I thought, wow, that's great. And one of the other brothers who wasn't pastoring goes, you know, what's the difference between a youth pastor and a lead pastor? And they said, it's really the same. I mean, as a youth pastor, you're dealing with teenage problems. As a lead pastor, you're dealing with adults with teenage problems. They're the same problems. They're just more grown up. And so yesterday, Chris and I were talking about some of the things that we've been working through. And we realized, you know what, they're teenage problems that just are grown up. And we all come into this walk of faith with problems, and we carry this weight sometimes. And I love this song that we're singing this morning, where it says, all you have to do is stay still. Right? All I did was praise. All I did was worship. All I did was bow down. All I did was stay still. So many times we get in our own ways trying to fix mistakes, trying to fix problems. Wouldn't it be better if we first took a beat, if we slowed down, if we sought God, if we looked at His Word and we thought, you know what, how am I supposed to tackle this rather than just diving in? Can we sing that pre-chorus and chorus one more time?
I thought I lost me, you knew where I left me. You reintroduced me to your love. You picked up all my pieces, put me back together. You are the defender of my heart. Save me, so much better your way. Hallelujah, great defender, so much better your way.
God, we come this morning and we bring our worship and we bring our praise, and God, we bring all of our baggage. We walk through the door with it. And there's so many things that can distract us from looking towards you. There are so many little things that are just pulling at our attention. A buzz in our pocket. The phone call we made yesterday, or the words said at work this week, or the wrong move that we made ourselves. And God, so much of it just weighs on our heart. So this morning we choose to come and to just stay still. to come into your presence and recognize that, that you can take our good choices and our bad choices and you can work them all for our good. That you take us from glory to glory. We're not going to be the same tomorrow as we are today. And so we make the conscious effort to turn towards you, to sit at your feet, to say, before I move, I'm going to stay still. God, we love you and we honor you. We pray that you would be in the rest of this service. We thank you for the work that you've already been working today. And we look forward to what you're going to do next. God, we're excited this morning. We ask all these things in the good and precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And amen. Good morning, church. You survived the snowpocalypse. Good job, worship team. Thank you all so much. These guys work so hard. If you haven't met Charlie yet, this is Charlie. He's taller than anybody else in the building. He's awesome. He's on his leave of absence now, but he was working Amazon 12-hour shifts from 6 o'clock Saturday night to 6 o'clock Sunday morning. He would drive here, take a nap in the parking lot for the last couple times he played for us, and he'd sleep from 6 to 8, come in, practice and be ready for church service. And so he's got his leave of absence now because he's going into basic training next month to play in the Army band. Army band. So he's got Army band. So excited to have you here, Charlie. Thanks for helping us out on the keys. Fantastic player, fantastic guy to get to know. So if you haven't said hi to Charlie yet, say hi to Charlie. Hi, Charlie. All right. We've got so much going on this morning. I'm just going to dive right into it. Well, actually, first, I'm going to let Carissa dive right into it. She's got something she wants to share, a new program that we're going to get involved with.
The church is going to partner with an organization called Luggage of Love, or Luggage for Love. And what they do is they fill bags for kids that are escaping vulnerable situations that are walking away with nothing. So they partner with CPS, kids that are usually taken out of homes and they don't have much on hand, and the emergency support shelter where they're taken out of domestic violence and sexually unsafe situations. And it's close to my heart because I was raised with foster siblings. My parents did foster care all while I was growing up, sometimes for a short period of time while the parent was getting rehabilitated and they were getting moved back into the home, sometimes for a week or so for respite care, and sometimes long term. I actually have an older foster sister that we adopted, and she's just my big sister now. But most of the time when those kids would come into our house, they had less than a backpack worth of stuff. If they had a backpack, it was pretty raggedy, but most of the time it was carried around in garbage bags, their things. And so the idea behind Luggage of Love is just immediately as the kids are pulled out of these risky situations, they're given a bag that shows somebody loves them, somebody cares about them. So the table in the back has little flyers if you want to fill a bag, if you want to fill part of a bag, if you want to just do like a little hygiene pack or a blanket. If you are gifted in some area, if you sew and you would like to sew some pillowcases, or you work with epoxy, you'd like to make some cute little bookmarks. If you work with wood, you want to make some fun little like tic-tac-toe games. Whatever giftings you have that might lead towards it, they have a big kind of storage area where they can put different parts of bags, and they take those pieces and put them all together to make bags. So if you're able to do that. We also have blank bookmarks and blank white cards and blank envelopes in the back, so you can take a few of those home with you and make them, put some encouraging words, some encouraging scriptures, something in the bags, because as they put them together, most of the time they don't have extra cards and bookmarks to put in those bags. So just something encouraging. The world is better because you're in it today. You know, I prayed over who would be receiving this bag, and that's you. I'm praying for you right now. You know, something like that that's just encouraging to them and encouraging their spirit that somebody loves them, somebody's thinking about them, somebody cares about them. So we have that table in the back if you'd like to check it out. For online service, we'll have a link tonight on the website where you can look at that list and see some different details. If you want to look them up, it's luggageoflove.us. They've been in the Cowlitz County and Kalama area for about 7 years now. So we're excited to be partnering with them. We're going to collect through March 14th. So if you want to bring anything in, you can just put it on that back table and we will get it all to them on March 14th.
So we've got this date night gift basket that was supposed to go out last week. However, we had 42 inches of snow. So we did not have service last week. If you came here, I hope you enjoyed the church by yourself. Maybe there was a few of you. I don't know. But I stayed home. It was good. I don't know what this is, but this looks important. It's the actual gift cards. We hid these from you in case somebody stole the basket. Again, you're all just grown-up teenagers, right? All right. So you have to be present to win. This one. Oh, I feel like he probably entered too many times. Robert Santiago, who was manning the basket this morning, just saying. Come on down, Robert. You and Wendy can have a wonderful night out. There is dinner, there is dessert, there is chocolate. I better hear that Wendy got some of the chocolate. Wendy, if you weren't around here for Christmas, Wendy made some delicious, what do you call it, English toffee. She gave us this basket of English toffee, and I was like, as a pastor, that is just like, that warmed my heart. I got English toffee. I took it home, and I sampled a piece that night. I'd had so much junk food that I couldn't eat it all that night. I sampled a piece that night. It was so good. I was looking forward to it. The next day was Christmas. Christmas afternoon, evening comes, and I go, you know what? I need a piece of English toffee, and I went to look for it, and had all been eaten by my family. It was rather sad. So, next year, I am looking forward to English toffee. I hope your family's nice to you. What else we got going on? We gave something away. We started a new program. Children's ministry. I know you're all dying to hear about how that's coming along. We've been working on the classrooms. They're getting remodeled. We've got new lights. We've got new heat coming. We've got new carpet in the 2-5 room ready to be installed. Things are moving forward. We are shooting for Easter. Easter Sunday, we're going to have kids rocking and rolling again. I am so excited for that. My kids are excited for that. We're going to be ready to go for our babies. Our 2-5s and our 6-10s are going to have so much fun. The classrooms are going to be well equipped. Thank you all for the donations that have been coming in. We have an Amazon wish list going, and people have been buying stuff, and it just shows up at the church, and I get to open the box and see what kind of fun stuff we have to put in these classrooms. We've got all kinds of new stuff. We've got new scissors and glue and pencils and pens and stations and tables and chairs and all the things that we need to set up our classroom. We were going through it, COVID hit, and we're like, you know, it might be time to look at the classrooms and see what needs to be done. And so we started pulling out some of the toys, and the toys were broken, and they were dirty and gross, and we thought, this is a perfect time to revitalize our children's ministry. And so we've been working hard on that. Our nursery in the back has been remodeled. You can check that out. It's like 99% of the way there, and everything else is coming along. I'm really excited for our kids to get back into children's ministry. It's important, very important. All right. Yeah, we can give it up for that. God is good. God is faithful. We have gotten everything that we need to be able to do what we need to do around here. And that's because of your guys' faithfulness. Thank you for your giving. Thank you for your gifts of service, your acts of love, all of those things. Although I know about a lot of them, I do not know about all of them. The sacrifices that each of you have made for the church. And it means so much to me. And I know it means so much to the Lord. And I'm excited to see where this thing goes in this next season. It's going to be good. All right. That's it for announcements, I think. Youth. Yes, paint night. Youth are having paint night on March 6th. See, I just started putting up fingers until I got there. March 6th, that's a Saturday. Youth are having paint night here at the church. They're going to be doing like a big Bob Ross video up on the screen and painting along on their canvases. All the supplies will be provided by the church, and it's just going to be a great outreach, a chance for kids in the youth group to invite kids not in the youth group as a non-threatening way to just get to hang out and have some fun. Our teenagers need to get together and experience life together again. Kalama had their first football game last night. Things are headed back in the right direction, so I'm excited about all that. All right, for real, done with announcements, which is good because we got a lot to get through today. We are in part 6 of our Without a King series. It's the book of Judges. We've been walking through this thing. If you've missed out on the first 5 messages, you can go back, check them out on YouTube or Facebook, or today we'll stand alone, so you won't be missing out on much other than the last few weeks have been awesome. All right, let's get into it. So this week, we had our snowstorm. We had a lot of fun. But there's times in our life where we make bad choices, and we compound our bad choices with worse choices. Last night, my kids, well, let me back up. Yesterday, spent a long day down here at the church. My kids were down here. Carissa came down later in the day. We spent a long day down here. So we're headed home for dinner. Saturday night's usually my dinner night to make dinner. And we were all feeling a little tired. So grabbed the frozen pizza, well-balanced meal, threw it in the oven, and we had dinner. the pizza got cut into 8 slices. There's 4 of us. Everybody gets 2 slices. My slices were gone like that. My kids eat bites this big, so they were still at the table. And I headed over to our living room. Our layout is like kitchen table, couch, living room, just to give you a picture. So I'm in the living room. They're still at the table. And I feel like I need to give my kids something that they haven't got all day, right? They've been playing. They've been doing their own thing. I haven't been with them much. And so I decide I'm going to start messing with the kids while they're eating dinner. So one of them, my son, had left his pillow on the couch, and so the pillow started doing a puppet show over the back of the couch. The kids started laughing. Carissa started telling them that they needed to knock it off and get back to dinner, and I was like, I'm not doing nothing. Threw them under the bus. And so they're giggling, but it needed to go bigger. It needed to be something that redeemed the day. And so I started thinking back to some of my youth group days. And as a youth pastor, the way that we would set up youth group in here, we push all the chairs to the side, darken down the room, turn up the music. Teenagers would come in like a half an hour before, right? And I wasn't a big music guy. I'm not like Robbie. I can't jam out on the guitar quite as well as he can. I can't do the duck walk while playing. It's all good, but that's not my jam. And so we would kind of circle up and do like this circle where everybody could jump in the middle and do their special thing, right? If that's the worm, you do the worm. If you can do a front flip, you do a front flip. And then you jump back out and somebody else gets to, it just gives everybody a chance to be the hero. And so to start this thing off, if we had a teenager that would jump in, great. But if not, the youth pastor has to be ready to start this thing off. So I had 2 moves. I could do a handspring and I could walk on my hands. I won't do it for you this morning, but I could do those 2 things. And so last night, my kids, I felt like they needed a little something extra. So while they're eating dinner, I tell them that I can walk on my hands. They're asking what I can do. I can walk on my hands. My sister, my daughter says, there's no way you can walk on your hands. So I decide I'm going to prove this. Now, I'm not the same age I was when I was a youth pastor. My back does not bend the same way that it used to bend. And you have to use your feet to balance yourself as you're going over. And so I did a handstand, and all of a sudden it wasn't quite as comfortable as it used to be. So I came down. She said, do it again. There's no way you can do it again. I was like, you're right, I can't do it again. And so I doubled down, and I grabbed the pillow, and I run to jump on the couch. And our couch is a sectional couch, 2 couches that come together. And where they come together, there is no cushion. There's just a piece of wood that sticks up. And so as I jumped onto the couch to continue my puppet show, I landed with my back on the couch. Bad choice compounded by bad choice. Yeah, it's been a long night. But we all have times in our life, and this is a goofy example, but we all have times in life where we make bad decisions and we double down and we use a bad decision to try to fix the bad decision. And we see that in Samson. We're going to look at the story of Samson this morning. And Samson's an interesting character in that he's the final judge who is supposed to deliver Israel, and it doesn't go quite the way that we would hope. But before we get into that, I want to read Romans 8:28. It says, and we know in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, he also glorified. So the idea here is that God can take anything and he can work it for our good. If we are loved by him, if we love him back, if we have this relationship, that he can work all things for our good, for our benefit. And so that's kind of the context I want to go into Samson with this morning. And so the thing about Samson is he's a judge just like all the other judges, and all the judges point to the final judge of Jesus. And they're all types, and they have these characteristics that point toward who Jesus is going to be and what he's going to accomplish. And Samson, unlike the other judges, is chosen before he's born. All the other judges, when Israel's oppressed and they cry out to the Lord raises up a judge, but it's somebody that's already alive. Samson's chosen before his birth. And so he's dedicated to the Lord before it even begins. And so we're going to look at this story of Samson. And first we're going to look at kind of how he came into the story in the first place. And this is going to be kind of our first portion, that he's dedicated to the Lord. If you're following along on your notes, they're on the website. You can scan the QR code in the entryway and pull up the notes. But number one this morning, looking at the story of Samson, is that we like to call the shots. We like to call the shots, right? Each judge points to a different aspect of Jesus' characteristics. And each judge has their flaws, but they all have this type of Jesus. And the birth of Samson is preceded by an angelic visit, just as Jesus's was. the angel appears to Samson's mother and indicates that she's going to give birth to the son that is going to be the savior for Israel. He's going to deliver them from the Philistines. So in Judges chapter 13, verse 2, it says, a certain man of Zorah named Manoah from the clan of the Danites had a wife who was childless, unable to give birth. The angel of the Lord appeared to her and said, you are barren and childless, but you are going to become pregnant and give birth to a son. And this story, though it's miraculous, we've seen this one a time or two throughout the word. Sarah and Abram were told that they were going to have a son and that he would become the father of many nations. Sarah, her response is to laugh. She's way old. She's like, this isn't going to happen. We also see Elizabeth and her husband, Zechariah, get told that they're going to have this baby, John the Baptist, and that he's going to prepare the way for the Lord. And Zechariah is doubtful, and so he's not able to speak for 9 months. We see this in Mary, and the angel comes to Mary and says, Mary, you're going to give birth to Jesus. And Mary's response is, let it be to me as you have said. And so we see this same type of response from Samson's mom. Samson's mom hears the word from the angel of the Lord, and she just takes it as fact, as this is what's going to happen. But often when we're looking for a miracle, we're looking for God to do something in a specific way. We already have it figured out. God, I need this miracle. I need this to happen. And God's like, I've got a whole different plan. His scope is way bigger than ours. Abraham hears the word from God, and it says that he didn't doubt in his heart that God could do it. In Romans chapter 4, verse 17, it's recounting the story. It says, I have made you a father, this is of Abraham, of many nations. He is our father in the sight of God in whom he believed, the God who gives life to the dead and calls into being things that were not. Against all hope, Abraham in hope believed, and so became the father of many nations, just as it had been said to him. So shall your offspring be. Without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead, since he was about 100 years old, and that Sarah's womb was also dead. Yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had power to do what he had promised. So Abraham gets this promise that he's going to be the father of many nations, and yet he's old. And against all hope, he believes. And he doesn't get how it's going to be done, but he just trusts God that it's going to be done. And not only does Samson's mom believe, but she's ready to do what's asked of her. She's supposed to raise the boy as a Nazirite. And there's some requirements that go along with that. And so the angel tells her that she can't drink wine just as Samson can't drink wine. She's supposed to be a part of this while she's raised, or while she's pregnant with Samson. I was watching this TV show this week, and the parents had three kids, and they were contemplating having a fourth child. And so they're going back and forth, and by the end of the show, they decide that they're done, that three is enough. They're rather tired. They're getting a little older, and they decide that they don't want to have the fourth child. And as they're sitting there in the closing scene, the wife's sitting there drinking a glass of wine. She's like, who am I kidding? I couldn't give this up for 9 months. That's where Samson's mom is, but she is going to give it up. And we see the boy raised as a Nazirite. Brings us to point number two. We're here on purpose for a purpose. Samson is chosen to be set apart. This Nazirite vow is all about Samson being set apart and being dedicated to the Lord. In verse 4, it says, now see to it that you drink no wine or other fermented drink, and that you do not eat anything unclean. You will become pregnant and have a son whose head is never to be touched by a razor, because the boy is to be a Nazirite, dedicated to God from the womb. He will take the lead in delivering Israel from the hands of the Philistines. So Samson is to be this set apart, chosen person to save the people. And the cool thing is that we also are chosen before birth. In Ephesians 1, verse 4, it says, for he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship. In Psalm 139:16, your eyes saw my unformed body, all the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. Jeremiah 1:5, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. You're chosen by God to be different. The Israelites are in this cycle of idolatry, enslavement, crying out to the Lord, and then deliverance, but they don't recognize that they're outside of God's protection until they're in trouble, until the enslavement comes, until the oppression is complete. So on a micro level, Samson is this small picture of what Israel is supposed to be at large, right? They're supposed to be a nation set apart. They're supposed to be a people not of the culture. They're not supposed to buy into the idolatry, the pagan worship. They're supposed to be different than the world around them. And so are we. And so on a macro level, the people of God are called to be set apart. And Samson's like this small picture of what it's supposed to be like. The charge to raise him as a Nazirite is out there. But Samson's dad has some questions. He hears the wife comes to him and says, an angel of the Lord visited me. He looked like a man, but he had this divine presence about him. And he came and he visited me, and now we're going to have this child, and we're supposed to raise him as a Nazirite. Manoah's response is not one of doubt. It's one of additional questions. Which brings us to number three, we want rules. Anybody else like rules? I like rules a lot. It gets me into trouble on game nights. We have game nights at our house, and whenever we get a new game, I'm always nominated to read the rule book, explain the game to everybody around us, and then we can play the game. And then when they start to break the rules, it's on me to be the judge and decide if they're following the rules or not. Usually it involves me bringing out the rule book and showing them that they're breaking the rules. They proceed to tell me that that's a dumb rule and that we shouldn't enforce that one. But it's in the rule book. We have to follow the rules. Are there to help us have fun. That's where I'm at. Some people are hardwired to follow the rules. Some people have a streak in them that says rules are made to be broken. In high school, we had this teacher, and he had all of this paid time saved up, banked up, and he was going to retire that year. And still don't know the whole story, but somehow he decided that he didn't want to be teaching this year, so he took his paid vacation for the rest of the year. So we had this teacher who was kind of a substitute for the rest of the year, and he didn't really care. As long as we got our work done, we were good. And so we would push all of our desks together, and the first 5 minutes, we'd split up the assignment. We'd all work on it together. As soon as it was done, we were free to do whatever we wanted. So we had this standing game of rummy going for 6 months in health class. It was a good use of our time in high school. I'm really good at rummy now. But the thing was, my friends liked to play with a rule that if you cheated and didn't get caught, it wasn't really cheating. It drove me crazy. It's not the way I like to play. But back to our story, Samson's mom goes to her husband Manoah, and she relays the information, and Manoah's response is found in verse 8. Manoah prays to the Lord, "Pardon your servant, Lord. I beg you to let the man of God you sent to us come again to teach us how to bring up the boy who is to be born." God heard Manoah, and the angel of God came again. Right, so Manoah's looking for some additional rules. He's like, I heard from my wife, but I need to speak to the Lord directly. I need some additional rules for how we're going to raise this boy. And I love this. This is exciting. God heard Manoah. Manoah's prayer is, God, come to me so that I can speak with you. And God heard Manoah. Prayer isn't something that either works or doesn't work. It's about a relationship. It's about a conversation. It's open communication with us and God. But what Manoah is looking for is this rule book. The Nazirite thing is good, but what other rules will govern the parenting of this child? The angel of the Lord comes back to him and basically just repeats what he already said to his wife, the unnamed wife. And there's no additional guidance. But then the messenger starts to reveal a bit about God's character. And that's really what the angel comes back for, is to reveal who God is to Manoah and Manoah's wife so that they'll be prepared to raise the child. Brings us to number four, rules lead to duty. Rules lead to duty. Once Manoah realizes that the angel of the Lord has no new rules to give, he offers some food as a sacrifice to this angel of the Lord. But this is possibly a pagan worship move. If he feeds the visitor, then the visitor will owe him. Right, this relationship is now trying to be formed into a contract. And that didn't go quite the way that Manoah was hoping. In verse 16, it says, the angel of the Lord replied, even though you detain me, I will not eat any of your food. But if you prepare a burnt offering, offer it to the Lord. So that the angel of the Lord's response is, you're not going to get this contract out of me. Why don't you redirect this energy to the one that it needs to go to? Why don't you focus on relationship with God rather than trying to make this contract and get on the rule game? So Manoah still just decides he's going to try and get this contract thing going. He asks for the angel's name. says in verse 17, "Then Manoah inquired of the angel of the Lord, 'What is your name, so that we may honor you when your word comes true?'" So there was this thing, if you could know the name of the deity, then you could somehow control the deity. So he's like, "Angel of the Lord, I want to know your name." Again, trying to solidify that contract. "Why do you ask my name? It is wonderful." For us, the picture's coming in a little clearer. This scripture, that name, wonderful, is used one other place in scripture. If you were around here at Christmas time, we kind of focused in on it. "He shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Prince of Peace." It's pointing to Jesus. And when the angel appeared to the wife in the first place, she's describing him to the husband, and she says that a man of God came to her who appeared as if an angel. So it paints this picture that this angel isn't the angel that we're used to seeing with the big wings. It's a different form. And now we're getting this picture that it could be Jesus. In verse 19, it says, "Then Manoah took a young goat, together with the grain offering, he sacrificed it on a rock to the Lord, and the Lord did an amazing thing. While Manoah and his wife watched, as the flame blazed up from the altar toward heaven, the angel of the Lord ascended in the flame. Seeing this, Manoah and his wife fell with their faces to the ground. When the angel of the Lord did not show himself again to Manoah and his wife, Manoah realized that it was the angel of the Lord." So again, pointing to this idea that this isn't the big winged angel that we're used to thinking about. And who else ascends to heaven but Jesus? So Manoah wants to know these rules, but the Pharisees had the rules, and they were considered dry bones. The rules turned into duty for them. So God hears Manoah, and he comes to him, but he has no new information for him that he didn't have in the first place. So why did God come back in the first place? Manoah needed what we all need. A revelation from God. The food was meant to solidify duty, and finding out the name was supposed to solidify duty. But all of this instead revealed that what Manoah needed most was a relationship with God, that Jesus himself was what he needed. You want to know how you're supposed to raise the son? Know God better. And I think that applies to us today. If we want God to hear our prayer. Manoah's praying and he's asking God to come. God hears his prayer and God hears prayer. Whether or not you're getting the result that you want, God hears prayer. Manoah wants rules and God says, "You don't need rules, you need me." So what are you praying to God about? And are you so focused on finding out what God has for you, or are you focused on getting closer to the heart of God? Parents, if you want to be better parents and you're struggling with your kids, the best thing that you can do is get closer to the heart of God. Kids and teenagers, are you struggling with your parents and the way that they're parenting you? The best thing that you can do is get closer to the heart of God. Are you struggling in your business? Are you struggling in your finances? Are you struggling in your relationships? The best thing that you can do is get close to the heart of God. Rules are not able to save us. Knowing who God is and relating to him is what provides direction and guidance and ultimately salvation. And the promise comes to pass and Samson's born. And in the next few chapters, we see Samson's life play out. And we would expect with all of this start to Samson's life, this divine start, and it says as he's growing up, the Spirit of the Lord stirred in him. We would expect that he would be this judge that they hadn't seen before. Maybe the judge that's finally going to break this cycle that they're stuck in. But instead, we see that he's short-sighted, he's hot-tempered, he's prideful, he's arrogant, and he's very impulsive. But through all of that, God loves him. And we're going to read the whole story. We're going to kind of take an overview approach to these next few chapters. Each of these episodes could take a sermon in itself, but we're going to touch down on some of these stories and then pull back up and see what we can pull out of Samson's life here for these next few chapters. So number one, we act on our worst impulses. And we see this played out in Samson's life. And there's times where we do things out of hastiness, right? Some of our worst choices are our moments in our day-to-day life where we just didn't take the time to think it through. We act based on our feelings, and feelings are God-given, feelings are important, but feelings aren't supposed to dictate our actions. However, Samson's impulsive, and he begins to act on his feelings, and it all starts when he sees a pretty girl. He goes down to Timnah, and he sees a Philistine. He comes back, and he says, "Dad! Boy, have I seen a girl, a Philistine down in Timnah. Judges 14, verse 1, it says, Samson went down to Timnah and saw there a young Philistine woman. When he returned, he said to his father and mother, I have seen a Philistine woman in Timnah. Now get her for me as my wife. Now remember, he is born to deliver the Israelites from Philistine rule. You know when you're watching the game on TV and you think yelling at the TV is going to do something? Go, go, go. Block on that side, block on that side. Yeah, and then when they score, you go, we did it, and you high-five everybody in the room, and you think that you did something. Or if you're like me, when you go bowling, you throw the ball, and you do this, because that's going to change the direction of the ball into the pins. That's how I feel when I'm reading Samson's story, right? I want to yell at the story. I want to yell at Samson, you're supposed to deliver the people from the Philistines. What are you doing? And that's basically how his parents react. They remember the promise of God, and they're like, can't we find you a wife from our own people? Do you have to go marry the Philistines? Do you have to settle in so much into this oppression that you're going to marry into it? He's supposed to be different from the culture. But Samson says, nope, she's the one. In my eyes, she is the one for me. Which brings us to point number two. Strength isn't a result of goodness. Samson's known for being this super strong dude, and the thing is, he's not a great guy. He's rather impulsive. He's got his issues with the ladies, to say the least. Verse 5, Samson went down to Timnah together with his father and mother, and as they approached the vineyards of Timnah, suddenly a young lion came roaring toward him. The Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon him so that he tore the lion apart with his bare hands as he might have torn a young goat. But he told neither his father nor his mother what he had done. Then he went down and talked with the woman, and he liked her. So Samson's got some anger issues, but, you know, just like anybody, if a lion jumps on you, you can fight back. But his response should have been to head to the tabernacle for cleansing afterward. He touched a dead lion. He's not supposed to touch dead things as a Nazirite. So I don't think you can fault him for taking out the lion. But then he hides it from his mother and father, which is the real issue here. This week, I was running out the door. I was a little hungry. It was lunchtime. I didn't have time to pack lunch. But there was a banana on the counter, and I thought, that banana looks okay. It's still a little green. It's mostly yellow. So I grabbed this banana, jump in the truck, and I'm getting ready to go. And I did one of those things. I hate this. Go to crack the banana, and it doesn't crack. It just squishes the top of the banana. Anybody else? Hate that? Hate that. And I'm sitting there in the truck, and I'm like, I don't have scissors. I don't have any way to cut this banana. And then this story pops into my head. You just got to tear it like I would a young goat. Cracked it right open. It's all in the mind, the mentality. Crack the banana like a young goat. But now that he's touched the lion, he's supposed to go get clean, but he doesn't because he's got a hot date. He's got to get to Timnah. And so he heads down there, decides he's going to marry this woman. So sometime later, he's coming back to Timnah for the celebration for the marriage. And on his way, he decides he's going to go visit the dead lion. Right, this is like revisiting the crime scene at this point. And when he gets to the crime scene, there's the dead lion. Inside this dead lion, there is honey. There is a honeycomb dripping with honey. And maybe he can reach in there without touching the dead lion. Maybe he can. But he's playing with that line. How close can I get to sin without crossing the line? At this point, he's playing with fire. And he goes, and I think we do the same thing, especially in our pre-marriage relationships. How far is too far? We know that there are certain intimacies that are supposed to come after marriage, but how close to the line can I get? When the question should be, how can I best honor God? Samson's supposed to be set apart. He's supposed to be this type of Jesus. And yet here he is saying, how close can I get? So he gets to Timnah, and there's a seven-day feast. Talk about a bachelor party. 7 days, him and 30 dudes are getting ready for the wedding. And he comes up with this riddle. And in verse 12, it says, let me tell you a riddle. He's talking to his 30 guests. If you can give me the answer within the 7 days of the feast, I will give you 30 linen garments and 30 sets of clothes. If you can't tell me the answer, you must give me 30 linen garments and 30 sets of clothes. Tell us your riddle, they said. Let's hear it. He replied, out of the eater, something to eat. Out of the strong, something sweet. To me, this riddle sounds very Lord of the Rings. It's very much the Hobbit type riddle. Any Lord of the Rings fans? Couple? All right, we've got a few. You've read the book. If you haven't read the book, the story goes, Bilbo Baggins is on this adventure with these dwarves. He gets separated from the dwarves, and he's not much of an adventurer on his own, but he gets lost down in this deep, dark cave all by himself. He finds a magic ring. He doesn't know it's a magic ring. It's just, to him, it's just a ring. He puts it in his pocket. He goes down deeper into this cave, and he's totally lost, and he comes across the character Gollum, also known as Smeagol, if you're into that kind of thing. So Gollum and Bilbo Baggins get into this heated conversation. Gollum wants to kill Bilbo. Bilbo just wants to get out of the cave. They strike a deal. Well, they'll have this contest of riddles. Whoever wins gets their way. If Gollum wins, he gets to kill and eat Bilbo. If Bilbo wins, Smeagol will show him the way out. And so they have this contest of riddles, and they get to the end, and Bilbo's stumped, and he puts his hand in his pocket, and he finds the ring. And just wondering out loud to himself, he says, "What is in my pocket?" Smeagol thinks that that is the riddle and is perplexed. That's not a fair riddle. I could not possibly know what's in your pocket. So he demands three guesses. And on his third guess, he actually guesses two extra guesses, string or nothing. And Bilbo has to escape on his own. That's the type of riddle that we're dealing with here. Out of the eater, something to eat. Out of the strong, something sweet. How could the Philistines possibly come up with the answer? They've got one way, though. He's got a problem with the ladies, and they know this. And so they go to his wife-to-be, and they say, "You got to get the answer for us." And so for 7 days, she mopes and pouts and pushes, and on the seventh day, he gives up the answer. He has no self-control. And so in verse 18, it says, "Before sunset on the seventh day, the men of the town said to him, 'What is sweeter than honey? What is stronger than a lion?' Samson says to them, 'If you had not plowed with my heifer, you would not have solved my riddle.' Then the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon him. He went down to Ashkelon, struck down 30 of their men, stripped them of everything, and gave their clothes to those who had explained the riddle. Burning with anger, he returned to his father's home, and Samson's wife was given to one of his companions who had attended him at the feast." It seems interesting here that Samson would have the Spirit of the Lord, that the Lord's favor would be with him. Samson's brutal, yet the Spirit of the Lord comes powerfully on him so that he can do amazing things. Earlier in this chapter, it says that the Lord was seeking an occasion to confront the Philistines. God's just looking for anywhere he can get his fingernails in to pry his people apart from the culture that they're integrating into. They're just a generation or two away from being totally assimilated, losing all identity as God's people. Redemption is a messy process, but one that God is always at work in, regardless of our shortcomings, regardless of our messed up motives, regardless of our bad choices. We have things in our past that we may not even remember, things that we've said, relationships that we've broken, that are going to come back around again. And that can be a scary thought. There's things in your past, there's things in my past that we don't even think about that are going to circle back around again. But the thing is, we could be a different person than we were when we made those choices. We may have been a Samson in the past and made impulsive, unwise choices, but when that circles back around again, is it going to find you still as a Samson, or is it going to find you as a Jesus? Our strength isn't a result of our goodness. Samson's strength wasn't a result of his goodness. Our strength is that God works out all things for our good. Our strength is that God chooses us, and if we choose relationship with him of our own free will, his Spirit comes and makes his dwelling among us. In Ephesians 1:13, it says, "And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession, to the praise of his glory." Our strength isn't caused by goodness. It's based on who we're in relationship with. Not even our sin can stop God from using us or saving us. It takes us to point number three. What we can do is different from who we are. What we can do is different from who we are. There's these gifts that the Spirit enables us. There's gifts of prophecy, of teaching, of hospitality. The New Testament is filled with all of these gifts of the Spirit. On the flip side, there are fruits of the Spirit. Galatians 5:22, it says that the fruit of the Spirit, can we see that one up on the screen? There it is. "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law." I love that. Against such things, there's no law. And we can have the gifts, but not have the fruit. In 1 Corinthians, it says that if I speak in tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not love, I am nothing. You can have the gifts, but if there isn't love, if there isn't fruit, the gifts mean nothing. What we can do is different from who we are. The fruit is who we're supposed to be. Against such things, there is no law. Number four, and we'll close with this, freedom is just a turn away. God has the ability and a willingness to spin our sin to accomplish good things. Things of our past can and will come back around, but we don't have to be the same person when it does. God can and will use our worst mistakes, our flawed choices, our flawed character to move us in the direction of being set apart. God's using Samson, and Samson goes back to the people and he finds out that his wife's been given away, and so his response is to go get 300 foxes. I don't know how long that takes. I've never caught a fox. He catches 300 foxes and ties their tails together, sticks a torch in there, and sends them out into the Philistine fields. It kind of ignites a war with the Philistines, and it starts to divide the people from the Philistines. You can go and read the whole story in chapters 14 and 15. We don't have time to go through it all, but I'd encourage you, if you have time this week, go read the story. It's funny, and it's encouraging, because it ends with Samson leading the people for 20 years. It's not a complete deliverance, as we see with Jesus. The Philistines are still in control, but God moves them in the direction of freedom. And this seemingly never-ending cycle of judges shows that God is eagerly waiting to jump in. And if we won't turn, he's eagerly looking for opportunities to pull us apart, to redirect our steps, to point us in the right direction. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 13 says, "We're not like Moses, who would put a veil over his face to prevent the Israelites from seeing the end of what was passing away. But their minds were made dull, for to this day the same veil remains when the old covenant is read. It has not been removed, because only in Christ is it taken away. Even to this day when Moses is read, a veil covers their hearts. But whenever anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away." Whenever anyone turns to the Lord. Now the Spirit is the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we all who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory are being transformed into his image with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. Our action is to turn to the Lord. The result is freedom. Freedom from what? Circumstances? No. Bad politics? Brokenness? No. Our environment can't provide freedom. Just like rules don't provide freedom. The freedom is transformation. The freedom is ever-increasing glory. It's being with God unveiled, face-to-face, with nothing dividing, no veil in between. Freedom, translated from the Greek, is being released, it's being liberated, it's being set free. It's this word picture of a jail cell being opened wide up, that the things that were holding you captive before are no longer holding you captive. But so often we just stay in the cell with the door wide open. The action that gets us to step out is turning to the Lord. Whenever anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. In this cycle of judges over and over again, what we see is the people cry out and God saves them. When the people realize how far they've gotten away, they say, "God, I've broken this relationship. I've done things that I shouldn't have done. I've gone places I shouldn't have gone. And now I'm separated from you. God, save me." And every time God's faithful to say, let's find the path back. Every time somebody turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Let's pray this morning. Lord, we thank you that there's this promise of freedom. God, we've acted impulsively. We've done things without thought. But God, just as Samson was called to be here, to be set apart for a purpose, God, we know you have purpose for our life. You have calling for our life. And we look to you and we ask that you would help us to see what that is. Lord, we have our own ideas of how you need to answer. And Lord, there are those this morning that are looking for a miracle. They're looking for a miracle in their health, a miracle in their finances, a miracle in their relationships, a miracle in their work, a miracle in their families. Lord, we lay down all of our preconceptions of what you need to do about this. And against all hope, we hope. God, we turn to you. We know the greatest thing that we can do this morning is turn to you. Just as Manoah asked that you would return, Lord, we ask that you would speak to our hearts, that you would give us hope, you would give us encouragement. God, we love you and we honor you. We bring this praise this morning because we know that you are a God who is willing. We know that you are a God who is able. We know that you see us and you hear from heaven. And we know that when you hear, you act. So God, we're believing that you are going before us even now. God, we're believing that you're working all things out for our good. And even if we don't know what the end game looks like, God, we know that you are good and that you are working all things for our better future, that we would come closer to the heart of God. And Lord, we just come and we ask that you would do these things in our heart. God, give us hope against all hope. We love you and we honor you this morning with this praise and worship. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Every chain is broken through you, Jesus. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Whoa. I am free to dance and sing. I am free, I am free. I am free to shout it out. I am free, I'm free. I'm free to dance and sing. I'm free, I'm free. I'm free to worship you. I'm gonna worship you. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Every chain is broken through you, Jesus. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Whoa.
We are excited. I hope you're excited this morning. Anybody else excited today? All right, I hope that was encouraging. I think it's going to be a good week.
We're going to close our service with a time of tithes and offerings. For online service, you can give one of two ways. You can give on our website at kalamariverview.com. There's a button on there where your giving is safe and secure through PayPal, or you can mail in your giving to Kalama Riverview, P.O. Box 1609, Kalama, Washington, 98625.
Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Every chain is broken through.